So I'm going to let this roll, because I think it's a given that you've got... I know when I spoke to you last week, you had 5 kids. Have you had any more since? I'm not sure if you've had any.
No, not that I know of. Probably, possibly a few more pets.
I think 5 is a good number. So I think that they're
Mama, I'll be fine if you
we need to see you, because we don't know if you're fine. How can we tell? You know, if you hurt your leg or something, we couldn't see you. Yeah. So you just have to be...
No, Sadie, this is the way conversations go in my house. So I'm used to
it. We'll put the lead on you. We have a lead. We'll put it back on. I should say, this all started about a year ago. I saw an article in the Irish Times. I think it was July 2016 or maybe June or whatever it was. And it was a lovely recognition of what people, you know, come to these kind of places for. I don't know whether that was the reason for writing it, or was it something like an exorcism that you felt I'd like to just put something out there that sort of explains who I am or where I am, or...
Yeah, I didn't initially mean for it to be published. I wrote it for a friend of mine who had a neurological diagnosis to persuade them to come and swim. And I had a journal that I kept been writing in for years, and just writing down thoughts and feelings about, you know, as they came up. And cobbled a lot of them together into the article and showed it to my husband, who is the guy who writes the articles, and he said it and said, "Oh my God, you got to send this to Roisin Ingall." And I was really nervous about it, saying, I don't know if I can take the rejection if she doesn't like it, you know. And he said, "No, Ruth, really." And he was quite dramatic about it. Then he sent Roisin an email saying, "Ruth, it's Ruth's time to speak," and all this kind of stuff.
Nice.
And my husband is a bit dramatic in that way. And she loved it. And then, you know, the reaction, obviously, people didn't think it was miserable. They really liked it, and so it was phew.
Yeah.
You got a really great reaction from it.
I know in this morning's Irish Times, Roisin has described you as obviously a writer and a mother and a self-described mermaid. She also said you're willowy. You're okay with willowy, I presume that's...
Willowy, is that a weeping willow? I'm not quite sure.
I'm not sure what that means.
A weepy willow.
Yeah. Hopefully, I don't think it would be the weepy thing. I think it would be more... you're kind of graceful and you can blow beautifully in the wind. I think
that's... I'll take that. Thanks, Paul.
Yeah,
that's
definitely
nice. Yeah.
But
okay.
the sense of when it going from being an article that was very, very well received to the book deal, was that quite a shock to you that people turned around and said, you know what, we really love this. We'd like to read more. We'd like it to be.
Yeah. Well, it all happened. It was, you know, really suddenly. Just all in one go. The article came out in January, and literally it did that whole viral thing on the internet, and then Roisin Ingall became like my... she was laughing saying, "Ruth, I'm like your secretary," because all these agents were ringing her trying to get in contact with me, and I had a few agents show an interest, and then it was sort of like pick and mix. So who will I go with? And I picked Sarah Williams and Sophie Hicks in England. She really kind of connected with the emotion and stuff, and she just kind of got it, and I really liked her style. And we just launched straight into writing the first few chapters to do a proposal for a book. And I spent all of February doing that, and by March that was finished. I had 6 chapters written, and we sent it off, and it was like... deal, boom.
It was a long day's journey tonight, because I know I'm an incredible writer and I can write.
You're incredible,
incredible.
Yeah.
Think about it.
Yeah.
I would think when approach, you know, with the idea of write a book, suddenly I've got to think in a larger arc, and I've got to think about the shape of it and how I'm going to, you know, go through. I don't know if that was all that a joy, or was there a kind of a dark journey into the night of figuring out, where's my soul in this, and what do I want to say exactly?
Yeah, well, I had kept this journal, not really a journal, not every day, but just, you know, sitting in parked cars between school runs and things like that, scribbling in my notebook, and I just date the top of the page. I'd been doing that for years, all through Son's diagnosis, so it was wonderful then when I went back to write the book. I had all this, it was really important to me that I wasn't writing in retrospect, and that it was sort of tainted by my idea of how things were,
right?
Because, you know, we do live very much in the present. It was wonderful. I had this this access into exactly how I felt at particular moments.
Great.
So I really used that as my template on how to write the book then, and it all came from that. So it doesn't really follow time chronologically, it's more emotions. So girly, I know. It just goes like from chapters are kind of based around different feelings, and then it kind of pops back and forth through time and things like that. So
kind of Bridget Jones' Very Wet Diary.
Oh God.
So that's a dreadful pun, I'll erase it from memory as quick as I can. But that, I know with the article I read, the initial article in the Irish Times, you spoke, I think, bizarrely, even though this is the most beautiful...
Looking for the
followed
kitties.
Your rules, right.
They always listen to me.
Look?
I'm just going to grab them.
Yes, we'll have a quick look. Hold on.
Sadie!
Sadie!
Hello? Hunter, can you bring Sadie back over here?
Back over here, please! Guys, look who's down at the beach. I think Mark is coming in. Do you want to go and say hi to him?
Sure, we'll talk up here while they're closer to them, because that way we're
there. Yeah. We always say hi to them.
So that idea, that's your mark, yeah.
Yeah. Do you want to go and say hi to Mark, guys?
No. As the book progressed, and obviously the actual coming to the cove and what you're dealing with, that idea that you've got some escape, you've got some way of, you know, your house is full of people and you need this other place to go to. You know, did the book kind of add another layer to that? Did it feel, I don't know, any kind of exorcism or salvation when writing the book?
Yeah, totally. I mean, like, it was a bit like therapy, you know. It's sort of an extension of the journal. It was me getting my feelings out and, you know, I probably became a bit of a weirdo when I was writing the book because it became so introspective. It was all about me and, you know, there are no kind of light conversations.
Welcome
no
to the
chit-chat.
World of the writer. There you
it's
go.
Like, how are things? Yeah, let's really talk about how you feel. Let's talk about me. I probably drove my friends mad. It was a strange year, but really, you know, really interesting kind of delving into yourself like that, you know.
And do you still find out, it's a kind of a, you know, for a lot of people, you know, the cove is almost like a secret place, even though obviously people know where it is. And
yeah.
And kind of putting it down on paper and putting it out there in bookstores, it becomes a bit more of a public place. Would your relationship to the cove and what you do change slightly, knowing that it's a kind of a published diary of sorts and people say, oh, okay, that's...
Yeah, I really hope it doesn't change. I mean, obviously in the summer it gets really busy around here, but during the winter it's really just us and the dogs. It's like dog beach down here. So I hope it stays that way, because I was saying to my friend Michelle, God, if it gets too busy around here, we're going to have to go up the mountains and swim in the lakes to get our kicks in the cold water, you know? So, yeah, I mean, it's lovely that if people want to share it, but it's my cove, so just back off, you know?
Yeah. as I was beginning to say now before we went looking for Hunter and Sadie, was the fact that that January 2016 article opened with the fact that you were cheating on Greystones with the Wicklow water. I think you were diving down, or you're going for a swim down Wicklow.
The
town.
Wicklow? No, I was only sitting there. I didn't swim. I was just sitting looking out at the harbour, saying it's kind of different here. But No, Greystones is my first love. I didn't cheat. No cheating.
You didn't consummate with.
No,
with,
no,
okay,
not
okay,
at all.
Just
no.
Just looked. Okay, that's just flirting, but no actual.
No,
okay,
no.
Okay.
I'm a Northsider. Northside Beach. Great. The Cove. That's me. Yeah.
You should mention fantastic. The Element Pictures, a great little Irish film company. They've opted the book as a movie. I think Meryl Streep's probably too old now. Maybe Jennifer Lawrence.
God, am I Meryl Streep? She's amazing,
well,
but yeah,
Streep
thanks.
Is great, but she might be a bit old for the role. She can play anything, but
yeah.
She would be ideal. But maybe we'll go with Jennifer Lawrence. I'll put a word in for you. I think Lawrence
Jennifer Lawrence. Woo! Yeah, wow. Thanks, Paul.
That must be kind of another layer of kind of mild crazy, where you think, oh, there's going to be a movie of me, of my life, you know, the slice of my life. And I mean, is that something that you will be heavily involved in? Do you feel, well, you'd like to step away from it now and let them do
yeah,
their
interpretation? It's kind of happening. I'm helping them write the script, so
right.
It's weird because you start talking about yourself in the third person a lot, which is really strange in meetings. But no, I'm really happy to be involved, because it's a bit of a challenge and a different kind of format and different kind of narrative structure, and so I'm giving that a go. And I'd rather be involved than have them, you know, turn it into something else. So they're amazing to work with. I'm working with the ladies in Element, and they're really intuitive, and it's so far so good. The treatment is done, which is basically like a big essay format of the entire script.
Right.
And so now I'm frantically reading Script Writing for Dummies to figure out how to put it into script form. But so far
so
good.
Every 5 minutes it's usually okay.
Yeah,
I mean,
a few songs would be really good, actually.
There
maybe
we
need some musical.
There
yeah. Musical at the Cove.
I'm thinking a lot of people know, obviously, with your somewhat overachieving husband Simon, 2008, Lou Gehrig's disease, but he's been, you know, My Name is Emily, incredible film, and he's written It's Not Dark Yet, and he just seems, you know, like yourself, he's an artist who seems to be able to express very, very well what's going on inside. Is it almost like a companion piece? I don't know whether you could dare sort of think, well, here's a couple who've both written a book from their viewpoint of what they're going through. So it's kind of a sort of sweet idea that it's almost like a companion piece. It's Not Dark Yet. I don't know.
It's kind of nice, his was written obviously at a different time, sort of earlier on in the disease, and this maybe is like a continuation. And that's the thing about M&D, is that it puts a couple in totally polar opposites, you know, of the same thing, really.
Right.
You know, that kind of idea, he can't move, I can, and you're dealing with something from totally different ends of it, you know. And
sure.
I mean, I suppose it's a weird situation that we're both have this feel compelled to write about it. For him, it's brilliant because, you know, he's so cerebral. Everything's, he's able to, he has still has that creative energy and that he's able to express himself. He's disgustingly talented. It's annoying.
Yeah, but
I know it is nice to think they're companion pieces. Like, luckily he liked it. I was a bit nervous about him reading my book, and yeah, he's okay with it.
I know comedians often joke when they're dating other comedians that, you know, when moments happen, they basically fight over who can use that. Like, if there's a magic moment or a funny moment,
yeah,
you know, they just sort of say, okay, I'm that's mine. I'm going to use that in my act. Don't, you can't have that, even though we both had this moment. I mean, I would think from a two writers' point of view that you, I mean, that sort of, you're obviously living a life and you've lovely kids and you've got a good life, but then you're also sort of aware now that you're kind of a, you know, you're an artist, so you're observing as well, or you're kind of aware. I don't know if that comes into it. Do you ever sort of talk about approaches? Or?
No, I mean, we don't kind of like argue over, over breakfast. I get that bit, you get that bit. They're very separate, I think, like, when it comes to the writing, Simon never reads my stuff until it's finished, and the same for me with him, because it would totally change the shape of it. If I was writing it worried about what he would think or vice versa, it wouldn't be what it was, and for me, the writing was very raw, and it had to be very, if I was writing it for somebody else, it would be something different, really, and it had to be very, I wanted it to be really true to the feelings behind it, you know. It's certainly from Simon's point of view, like, when I read his writing, it was as wonderful for me as other people, because it was like a window into how he was feeling, and hopefully he feels the same about mine, because, I mean, you know, essentially we're married, but every person is an island, you know. I mean, we're all individuals, and it's
you
always
feel the same way when you read the guide. You feel like you're looking into my soul, and you know
absolutely
exactly.
Paul,
that's what I reach for every time. So we should say that the book is out there, of course, and a lot of lazy people just go to Amazon and stuff, but it's the fact that it's in the Village Bookstore here in Greystones, it's kind of a nice
It's out in Greystones before anywhere else. It's out everywhere else next week.
Take it to court, I think,
possibly. I think they were allowed, but they gave it to Greystones for the first week. It's not out until next Thursday the 6th everywhere else, so Greystones got it first.
I know that the Irish Times have a piece this morning. Do you have to do a little bit of promotion now, or is it a, is it sort of let it do its thing, or?
a little bit on the 6th itself. I'm kind of being brought around Dublin to do signings and things like that, and then the following week I have to go over to England to do some stuff over there.
Oh yeah, we got to wrap it up. Hi. Now you're wanted over there.
Yeah.
And so when can we expect to see Jennifer Lawrence on the screen?
Who knows? Let me get the. I better finish that script writing for Dummies book first and get going on it.
Nice.